And today I'm trying to introduce the human retinal mapping research and talk about the challenges of the human retinal mapping research. And also I'm trying to introduce a mathematical framework which we want to use to quantify the retinal mapping, and so that we can reconstruct the retinal mapping. And then lastly, I will briefly introduce our recent progress with the proposed mathematical framework. So what's the human retinal mapping? So the human retinal mapping idea is that by controlling the stimulus on the human's retina, and then by analyze the response on the human cortical surface. So as we know that the cortical area is the largest, single largest area in the brain, human brain. So basically a good understanding of the region on the retina, image on the retina or on the cortical surface could provide us the insights for the human vision structure. And because the visual area is the largest area, it actually is the most promising for us to get the clear and the very detailed description on this kind of mapping. And so basically, for example, many questions can be asked for this line of research. For example, how the region works and how many visual regions are in the human human vision area system, and what's their relationship. Also, in terms of the clinical impact, so this kind of understanding could help us to understand the brain development and also help understand the, for example, the brain plasticity, for example, for the blindness people. And actually their cortical blindness could be cortical, the visual area could be used for other purposes. So this kind of research could provide us a good understanding about the brain plasticity. Meanwhile, for example, some people had the cortical blindness. It's like, for example, because of the car accident, and some visual region may be damaged. But however, if we know that the location, the mapping on the exact location on the retina, it could help us to design the neural rehabilitation so that we improve the brain vision. Actually, it's also very interesting. I want to say that many years ago, Anqi invited me to visit her school, and actually introduced this topic to me. And so after many years, and finally right now, we think we can find a good way to quantify this mapping. So when we talk about retinal mapping, we know that we have better understanding on the mammalian. So for example, monkey visual cortex. By sacrificing the monkey and, for example, insert the electrode on the monkey's visual area, and our understanding is that there are literal retinal mapping between the, on the left, we see the visual field, and on the right, it's the flattened the monkey visual area. You can see that, for example, the fovea area, and the 1, 2, 3. So basically, you can see their topology connected, and further, actually, they are conformal. So it means that the local area angle are preserved, local area have the strong similarity. So as a result, back in 1977, Professor Schwartz proposed that he proposed the log transform format. And this indicates that all the mapping between the visual field to the cortical surface should be a conformal mapping. And actually, based on this his hypothesis, many excellent work are done. For example, the double sesh work, and also the new work, so that using this simple and elegant log transform. By the way, this is a conformal map function. So then using this simple complex log transform, and we had much better understanding for the human brain, and also for the retinotopic mapping. So for the in the animal model, and we can do the electrode to get the invasive understanding, but for the human, so basically we need to take a non-invasive approach, which actually people find that the function MR can provide a good non-invasive way to find the human retinal mapping. So the basic procedure is as follows. For example, when people see some visual stimulus, for example, rotating bar or some of the eccentricity rings, and then meanwhile record the function MR on the each voxel on the visual area, and then to analyze. For example, the visual stimulus on the left eye will go to the right hemisphere, and on the right eye will go to the left hemisphere. And so that for each of the functional MR sequence on cortical location, we find the perception center and the perception size. There was a breakthrough in 2008. And so basically Dunlin and Mandel proposed the population receptive field, PRF model. It used the hemodynamic function and using the convolution so that actually by this method, and we can finally compute the rho theta, for example, the visual coordinates on the cortical surface. So basically the PRF model became very popular and became a very useful tool for us to analyze and understand the human retinal map. So however, there are still some questions remain, even with the newly proposed PRF model. For example, since we know the mapping on the animal model is conformal, it was validated on monkey, on the fish, the visual area. And then a natural question is that is the human retinal mapping conformal? So this is a good question. And also, meanwhile, how can we quantify? So basically, in the past, this kind of research only analyzed, for example, a group of five people, and then so that they can identify different visual area. So it turns out that human has lots of visual area, up to 12. But how can we analyze, how can we integrate them within some mathematical model or some numerical measurements? So this is a big challenge. Another one is that since the current model will actually change the original functional MR data. So the question is that with from the description, can we reconstruct the original visual space, the information? And for this kind of research, I have to see that in 2018, HCP, they released the high resolution 7 Tesla retinal map data, including 181 healthy young adults, which has the functional MR data. So this kind of data is the foundation actually provide as a good resource for us to develop and validate our mathematical model. So for example, in this here, and you can see that the HCP data already identify the V1 area, V2 area, and V3 area. So this kind of data provide us the foundation for us to develop the proposed algorithm. So here we propose a framework which utilize the quasi-conformal mapping, and so that we can use the Beltrami coefficient to analyze and to represent the retinal mapping. So I use this picture to briefly explain the idea. So for example, in the middle, we see the cortical surface area, and this red area is roughly the visual area. And then in our research, we find the mapping, we build a structure, the anatomical conformal mapping from the visual area to a disc. And then we can discover, we can study the mapping between the parametric space and the visual space. So which we simplify the visual space on the retina also as a disc. So we study the F. And then meanwhile, actually the because the FR is the retinotopic mapping we study, which we go from the goes from the visual field to the cortical surface. So in the results, we study the F equal to the inverse of the FR and the compose with the C, the inverse. So basically the it has two benefits for this, at least has two benefits for this framework. First of all, is that the our vision is that because of the structure wise, the C is a conformal mapping. So it means that the we can by study the conformality of F, we should know, we should validate, we should be able to validate the conformality of FR, so which is the retinotopic map. Second thing is actually the after this, with this framework, eventually we study a mapping between two disks, which it well defined in the complex plane. So we realized that actually the in the mathematical research, in geometry research, there's a quasi-conformal Teichmuller theory, which well studied the mapping between two complex planes, the two disks. So in some sense, we always see that maybe the almost this quasi-conformal Teichmuller theory will return to for us to study the retinotopic mapping. It provides a very theoretical rigorous framework and a very clear the numerical method. So we developed numerical method and then so that this becomes the very elegant and powerful framework for us to study. So today I'm trying to introduce our framework. So the idea is that the we study the F and then we compute the Beltrami coefficient map and then use the Beltrami coefficient map to quantify the mapping. And then to we want to first question we want to ask is that whether the human retinotopic mapping is conformal or not. And after that, I will briefly introduce the following work with this we developed with this powerful this called Beltrami coefficient map. So we use this Beltrami coefficient map and to do basically we did the more smoothing and we did the restriction and also we even try to improve the PRF model. So here are some basic the background and which I repeated for many, many times, but mainly was on the anatomical research. So basically the, we try to study the conformal mapping between the different manifold and the conformal mapping only maintain the local shape and also the angle preserving. For example, this is the visual area, and this is the log transform model proposed by Professor Schultz. So this is actually the log is conformal. You can see the local area, local angle well prepared for the between this in this map. And mathematically, the conformal mapping only changed by the first monotone form, only changed by scale. So basically, propose to utilize the Beltrami coefficient, which is defined as a partial F partial Z bar divided by partial F partial Z. So for example, if you can see that from A to C, which is conformal. So the circle on the source still preserved on the circle on the target. So in this mapping, if we compute the mu, since because of the Cauchy-Schwarz Schwarz-Riemann theory, we know that partial F partial Z bar equal to zero. So mu equal to zero. However, if only quasi-conformal, it means that the is not angle preserving, but topology preserving. So the other result is the mu, actually the, it's a quasi-conformal mu, the maximum of the norm is less than one. So basically the with further with mu, we can define, you know, the K, which measure the distortion direction. So very simple definition, and it turns out actually the extremely powerful to analyze the retinal maps. So in the end, we borrow the Teichmuller theory. So basically Teichmuller theory said that if Beltrami coefficient mu f satisfies the infinity norm less than one, and this mapping is topology. Using our restriction language, we obviously this is diffeomorphic. And also an additional benefit, actually the best part with this Beltrami coefficient is that the with three fixed points and this Beltrami coefficient map uniquely determine a diffeomorphic map. It means that the, you know, the, we have two disks, and then suppose I present you a disk of Beltrami coefficients, and we are very confident with this map we can uniquely construct the mapping from the visual field to the parameter space. So basically, this is the power of the proposed Beltrami coefficient map. We borrow the idea from the Teichmuller quasi-conformal theory and use them to analyze the retinotopic map. So this is a system pipeline. Basically, on this side is the PRF model, and the middle part we do the smoothing. We use the conformal flattening and the thin plate spline smoothing, and later on we use the quasi-conformal. We is compute the Beltrami coefficient map. Okay, first step, conformal flattening. So as I said, mainly we want to study the mapping between two disks. One is the visual field, the other one is the conformal map of the disk. And then we want to analyze this map so that we need to have, first of all, we have a conformal flattening of the visual area. And what we did was, for example, we want to increase the surface resolution to push the conformality map of the structure map to the limit. So we used the loop subdivision algorithm to increase the cortical surface and use Moonchance, the weighted spur harmonic, to interpolate the smooth surface. And then meanwhile, we cut a patch which started from the foveal area and then to satisfy some of the geodesic threshold. And we use the harmonic map to disk. And then we use we take the Beltrami coefficient as the inverse of the H mu. And then we can make the mapping, it's conformal. So as I said, so there are multiple ways for us to do it. For example, we can use our spherical conformal mapping, and then we cut them and do the stereograph projection. We can cut disk. The reason we take this so many different steps is that we really want to push the improve the accuracy of the conformal map, and so that it will help validate our validation or conclusion about the conformality of the conformal map. And then, you know, for the retinotopic mapping research, the most annoying is the noise of the functional MR data. So basically, if you look at this functional V1 area, and if we, on the disk, if we draw them with the identified the rho theta, you can see there are lots of overlap. It means that although the rho theta on the visual field coordinates, visual coordinates are topological, but on the other, actually the what we return the data actually are very noisy. They are not a topology. So there are several methods was proposed to study this problem. For example, the anti-cheese mesh spectrum based smoothing, and which was a big success. And so basically we also apply the Beltrami coefficient map, and we did some Beltrami smoothing. And in this work, we took a light, but yet the efficient approach. So what we did was we have a disk, and then we using the rows and the theta to build a manifold, and then we use the thin plate spline so that we can smooth them. You can see that that's the first line, the first row is the original method, original the results from the PRF model. But after the smoothing, and we can get the a very good V1 area, and so the with better the smoothing results. Okay, so here comes down of it's how can we compute the Beltrami coefficient maps, and so the idea is that the event we because we know the C is the conformal map, and then we can study the you know the mu f, which we validate mu f whether how close. Whether the mu f is zero or how close mu f is a zero. So basically to compute the mu f, we using the, we compute the gradient of the gradient of the tetrahedral mesh, triangle mesh. And then we can define the mu f. And then after we get the compute the Beltrami coefficient map, and we tested our algorithm with all 181 observers from the HCP data, high resolution 70 data. And here are the results we got. Here we have two visual fields, left and right, and from one is from the right hemisphere, the other from the left hemisphere. And we compute the Beltrami coefficient on each voxel. and then we put them together because of the noise data, and we almost cannot make sure that all the data are valid. We use the valid data because from the PRF model we have a confidence value. So for example, in this one, we look at each point. I find the greater than 45. So as long as the 45 sub observers have valid the signal Beltrami coefficient on this point, we counted them and we compute their average. And then this is the 90 subject and this is the 145 subject. You can see that with more subjects, and then actually we have reduced the Beltrami, valid Beltrami coefficient map. But however, from this picture, we can see that the majority region actually close to blue, but there are some region actually, especially close to the foveal region, which are least conformal. Okay, so with this map, and can we draw any conclusion? So we did some the following analysis. For example, as I said, for the structure side, for this F, for this C, we might compute the average of the BC as 0.0092. So it's close to be conformal. And however, with this F, mu F, we can only get 0.31 and 0.312. So it means that I also show the histogram. So it means that although the C is close to conformal, but F is far away from the conformal. So we conclude that the V1 retinal map of human vision area were not conformal, but quasi-conformal. But you may argue that, okay, so right now 70, how about 11T, or how about better results? We believe that maybe future studies with more advanced measurements could improve the sampling resolution and maybe improve the BC Beltrami coefficient estimate. But the mathematical framework we developed here is still valid, will be able to apply to the better high resolution results in the future. Okay, the last question we try to answer is that from the retinal map, the parametric space, can we go back to the visual space? So the question is that given a point on the cortical surface, can you tell me that which location it maps to the visual field? But we know that there are multiple visual regions, and among them, V1 is the largest one. So we focus on the V1. So basically the traditional quantification method will take a template. So basically the log transform, and then it means that all the original signal were destroyed. But for our Beltrami coefficient map, we can actually, with the algorithm, we can reconstruct the map. So example, from here, this is the visual field, and what we get, BCM, and then we can reconstruct the visual field. So it supports the notion that our representation is complete, and also could benefit the future medical analysis. So here I briefly introduce the work. How can we compute the Beltrami coefficient? How can we reconstruct the diffeomorphic mapping based on the BC map, Beltrami coefficient? There were actual research on this topic, for example, the Beltrami holomorphic flow or the rich flow. So rich flow idea is that because the quasi-conformal can be formulated as a change metric conformal. So it means that we design the remaining metric, and then later on we can apply the normal conformal mapping algorithm to compute the quasi-conformal. So in this work, we adopted the linear Beltrami solver. So with this algorithm, actually it's based on the generalized Laplace equation, and so that it has a strong numerical stability. So the whole idea is that we have our Beltrami coefficient definition, and then if we apply them to the UV coordinates, and after that, we define the partial U1, U2 on both sides, we can have this following equation. So if you work on the spectral analysis, you should feel this equation very comfortable. The reason is that the two gradient, the divergent of the gradient, which is actually the two nabla is the divergent of the gradient method, divergent function, which actually is very useful, very stable to be computed. And the only difference is that the normal the spectral analysis, they assume an isotopic A. So it's a diagonal matrix. But here, every alpha, alpha 2, alpha 3, they are not asymmetric. So they have the, they call it the generalized, the Laplace equation. So basically, we employ the divergent compute the formulation, and then we can plug in, then so that we can get this generalized Laplace equation. So basically, the idea is that with the rho theta, rho and the tau, and then we can reconstruct the f. So the u we have with v and with the rho and the c, rho and the tau, we can go back to the u. And following this idea, we recently we also did more work. For example, the Beltrami smoothing.
So basically, with the proposed retinotopic map, and recently we studied the Beltrami smoothing, and we studied the registration. So the idea is that with high resolution HCT data, we could use them to analyze the 3T data. So let me conclude my work. In this talk, we present our mathematical framework to quantify the retinal map, and then the work could improve the understanding of the cortical organization and also could be applied to other sensory modalities. Okay, here are my collaborator, my PhD students, and also collaborator Professor Lu from the NYU. Okay, that's all my talk. And then this picture explains the mapping. So what we see on the retina image, and then we can reconstruct which on the functional output. Okay, thank you so much. Sorry for the technical trouble.